Please welcome back to the stage, Ben White.
Wow. I wish I had that introduction all weekend. Just once, but that's okay, guys. This is the last time that you're going to see me this afternoon. Thank you guys all for coming. We do have one last presentation for you guys. I want to invite to the stage Jeff Hambleton to talk about Airy. So, ladies and gentlemen, please give it up for Jeff.
Okay, I think I have this thing on. Thank you, everyone, for coming out. Check out everything that's going on over here at Articat today, this weekend. This is a real pleasure to be up here on this stage to get to talk to you guys about avalanche education and avalanche incidents and why it means so much to us as a community. Many of you know that Articat lost a team member a number of years ago, Rob Kincaid, and they've been invested in avalanche education before that, but since that, in an even more like direct and dedicated effort. Part of that is their partnership with Airy to showcase what avalanche education looks like in the motorized community and to bring people together to tell stories and learn things about avalanches. Avalanches are an unfortunate, maybe surprising, and even, I don't know, they're catastrophic to the community they happen in. They're a serious business. And so when we talk about avalanches, there's a lot to learn and a lot to unpack around them. My goal today is to talk about two things. I want to talk about an avalanche accident that happened last season, an avalanche accident that killed one of our co-riders. So I'm going to take on a pretty sensitive subject today, and I hope that you don't find it disturbing, but the family and the friends of Alex Ballesteri want this story told, and they want people to understand the hazards, and they want to improve the way we talk about avalanches. So that's the motivation behind sharing that accident. But I also want to point to what's happening in avalanche education and how the scene and the landscape has changed in the last few years and what's happening. So to begin with, I'd like to get to know a little bit about everybody that's out in front of me. So raise your hand for me if you've been out west and have ridden in avalanche terrain or in the big mountains. I want to know who has experience with this. Okay, so like half the crowd. That's what I kind of expected. Most of you guys live out here. How many people have dreamed of going out west and want to ride in the big mountains? Okay, that's a few more hands. So the interest in being in the places where this thing called avalanches happen is it's contagious, right? We want to be out there riding in it. So we got to confront this risk a little bit. We can't just ignore it. So what I'm going to do today is walk us through a couple of slides telling a story about what happened last year to Alex and his friends and how that turned out. And then I'm going to tell you guys a little bit about what's going on with modern avalanche education for snowmobilers. And then we're going to show a video here at the end of this presentation showcasing what the Black Cats athlete team has been up to the last couple of years working with Airy course providers to improve their avalanche education to pursue this idea that they can ride and develop their teamwork, they can improve their skills, they can recognize avalanche hazard, and they can play in the mountains around avalanches and not have accidents. Now, avalanche education doesn't work all the time, and avalanche equipment doesn't work all the time, so we're going to dive into this a little bit and sort of poke some holes into what was going on. So here we have our first shot. This is Poker Creek in western Wyoming. It's a pretty awesome looking place to ride, huh? Big broad valley, lots of snow. Cool terrain features to go play on. I mean, that's like a skate park for snowmobiles back in there. There's all sorts of stuff to do. And you can see that there's some big slopes in the background. There's a big slope in the foreground on the right here. But the avalanche that happened, that we're talking about, happened right here in this little corner. This little slope at the bottom of the picture here is the one that caused the avalanche accident. So recognizing avalanche terrain and where it is in the mountains is part of it. The reality is these riders probably did identify avalanche terrain in that they saw this big slope here to their right, and they're like, yeah, we don't want to be on that or underneath it, so we're going to go around it. They made a good choice. They also checked out the avalanche forecast that day. They'd looked at what the conditions were doing. They'd read the reports. There hadn't been reports of recent avalanches for multiple days. Things had calmed down. In fact, the Avalanche Center had downgraded the avalanche forecast hazard rating from considerable to moderate. Now, what's the difference between a considerable and a moderate avalanche danger rating? We're talking about orange to yellow on the danger scale. When the avalanche danger rating is considerable, it says that natural avalanches are possible, but human-triggered avalanches are likely. So if you go out and ride in avalanche terrain, it's likely that you will trigger an avalanche when there's a considerable avalanche danger rating. Orange is also when the best snow is out there because it's the freshest, deepest, funnest time to ride. So a little bit of a challenge there. Now, what does it mean when it says moderate? What does that downgrade mean? It means, it says that a natural avalanche is unlikely, but the human-triggered avalanche is still possible. If you get in the right piece of terrain in the right situation, it's still possible to trigger an avalanche. So reading avalanche forecasts and interpreting that as a group, deciding how you're going to respond to that, that's something they did well. They created a plan. They had something they were going for there. So they understood the risk, and they had a plan to manage the risk. Now, one thing I'll point out about that avalanche forecast is they mentioned an old layer from a month before. They were still tracking an old snow layer that was buried on January 28th. This avalanche accident happened on February 23rd. So a month later, over the course of the season, we're talking about an old layer in the snow that was still reactive and still being tracked by the forecasters, but it wasn't producing avalanches regularly enough to issue any sort of warning. In fact, they downgraded the warning. So you can imagine the complexity of trying to forecast for avalanches. It's even more difficult than the weather, and we have less modeling to do that with. So it's an uncertain environment. We try to suggest where the avalanche problems might be and even what the character of that avalanche problem might be, but it's an uncertain science. So we got to start with that uncertainty and think about that. But yeah, these guys, I mean, Alex and his team members, they'd all been to avalanche courses. They had rescue training. They'd taken the level one. They'd even taken the level two course. These guys had pursued avalanche education, so they were not caught by surprise. What's interesting about this avalanche accident is it caught the rest of us by surprise. Forecasters, educators, we looked at this and we're like, really? Wow. I can see it. I can see what was going on there, but we're surprised by the situation. So follow through with me here as we dive a little bit deeper into this incident and take a look at what happened here and sort of understand some of the things that we were looking at here. So we're looking at the avalanche terrain. We're looking at the conditions that were going on here. And we're talking about the training and the response that the team had into the situation. So here's Alex's trajectory across the slope. He's working left to right, working up around the corner here. And by the tracks up above on the upper right, you can see this area has been hit before, and there were no signs of instability. So this kind of looked like a good place, a good option for them. And as he turned around the corner, his partner said they watched the tail end of his track wash out, and they watched him deploy his airbags. So they knew he had been, like, caught an avalanche. So they're like, oh, dang, that just happened. Now they had to respond. So one thing I can say about this is from this picture, what do you think the slope angle is on this slope right here that we can see in profile? When we measure that slope angle, it's above 30 degrees. 30 to 45 degrees is the slope angle where most slab avalanches happen. So we can recognize avalanche terrain by slope angle. And that's something we can look back in hindsight and say, wow, that is avalanche terrain. Is that recognizable at 20 miles an hour on a snowmobile? It's tougher. It's a lot tougher. So the challenge for us is actually the read and run. How do we spot this stuff on the fly? And if we have something to learn from this avalanche accident, this is one of the things. It's learning to read and run terrain. And how do you slow your group down when there's questions and make a better analysis over the terrain? Those are some things that you can learn and practice in avalanche courses. I'll talk more about that in a second. But let's return to the scene here. So when Alex's partners came around the corner, this is what they saw. This is not a large avalanche. That's a 3 or 4 story hill. Now, they said that Alex's airbag had been deployed. Do you guys think that that slope is tall enough for an airbag to have an impact in the getting to the top of the debris? It wasn't. So this is one of the limitations with airbags that we can't get around. They require a certain size and characteristic of an avalanche path to be effective. In this case, it wasn't enough. So the airbag basically notified his partners that he'd been caught in an avalanche. That's about what they got out of it. Now, the avalanche debris, you can see this is probably a 2 to 3 foot crown up there in the thickest spot. So not a ton of snow, but it is an older snow layer. It's down in the snowpack. So it wasn't something they could see from above. There's a couple of takeaways here. One is the terrain. You can see that it's kind of a steep knoll. And in fact, by looking at the crown, you can see that it's a little bit of a wind-loaded piece of terrain. The wind puts extra snow, extra load in that spot. So that makes it a spot that's a little more susceptible to an avalanche just based on its characteristics to the wind, its relationship to the wind. The height of the snow, the slope, and the angle of the slope are the other two things we can look at in the terrain and sort of figure out what was going on there. That's a steeper piece of terrain. It's significantly steeper than anything around it. In fact, it's probably the steepest little feature in the zone. So it may not have seemed like that as they came around the corner from the left, but once they were on it, they probably realized that that slope was steep, and I'm guessing that triggering the avalanche was both like, oh, I thought I saw that coming, and also a surprise. That's how I would read it if it was me. Be like, oh, shoot, I'm on this thing, and oh, darn it, now it's breaking. What do I do now? So unfortunately for Alex, he ended up in a terrain trap, and that's what's unique about this setting right here. In this terrain, all of that stuff comes right down into a creek. So there's no option to get out of that, and he didn't have any space to run. So he was trapped. He didn't have a chance to get out of this, and I think this is what happens to snowmobilers a lot, is we come into the terrain low, we work our way up and across, and we get caught from avalanches that propagate up and above and come down on us. And that's something that's unique to snowmobiling. If you're a skier, you probably enter the slope from the top, and maybe you have a chance to get out of that. But snowmobilers are actually uniquely vulnerable to avalanches from above because we travel through the valleys. And when there's weakness in the snowpack, we can affect the slopes above us. So it's something to think about when you're traveling in the mountains is what is above me all times and being able to inventory and keep track of that. Now, the other takeaway from this is in looking at the snowpack. So there was a profile done by the Avalanche Forecast Center, which they always do after avalanche accidents. We always dig in the snow and try to figure out what the cause or the root relationship was in the snowpack that set this up. So in the profile, which looks a little something like this, it's a top-to-bottom graph of the depth of the snow and the different layers and how they relate to each other by hardness and by grain type, what they're composed of. And what we see here is here's our weak layer. Can you guys see it in the graph? It's kind of this trapped, isolated little layer in the middle right there, and that's the weak spot in the snowpack that they were tracking. That's the note that they were giving in the forecast about the January 28th layer that was buried. Now, that's not easy to do, and even just digging in the snow isn't going to tell you that it's there because it probably wasn't everywhere. It was probably something that was just specific to that piece of terrain, pretty isolated. So digging snow pits may or may not have helped them understand that this hazard existed, but reading the forecast gave them a clue. So they understood that that was going on, but they weren't finding any evidence that it was an issue. I don't know if the guard was down or what else was going on, but at any rate, they entered this piece of terrain and it had a consequence, and somebody got caught and somebody got killed. And that's, I think, what catches us all by surprise when we talk about these sort of things. So, you know, the rescue. Alex's partners had been to avalanche rescue classes. Everybody knew what to do. They had the gear. They were wearing avalanche transceivers. They had the avalanche probes and shovels in their packs. They were ready to respond. They were riding the way they'd been taught. And those two guys, they dug for over 30 minutes. They dug their hearts out. They dug as hard as they could. But avalanche debris from an old snow avalanche is thick, it's heavy, it's blocky, and it's hard to move. Those two guys probably moved 4 tons of snow before their efforts were exhausted. That was inside of 30 minutes. After about 30 minutes, they got some help. Search and rescue was able to respond rapidly to this scene. And within an hour, there was a search and rescue team on site, and they helped them dig down and get to their partner. But it was too late at that point. Avalanche rescue is something we got to do in 10, 15 minutes. We don't have time to call for help and get extra help to come on board. This is a skill that we manage as riding teams within ourselves. And I got to hand it to these guys. They dug as hard as they could. They did everything they could to save their buddies. So, I mean, this is in no way pointing to the default or a mistake that they made there. They did their best. But you can imagine the effort they had to go through to get through all that snow. And so, you know, at the end of the day, the terrain trap, the situation, that's what complicated this avalanche accident and it had consequence. It would have been a non-consequential slide if it hadn't been for the terrain trap in this situation. So what I want you guys to come away from this is the idea that recognizing terrain traps is one of the most important things that we can do when we're out riding. We're riding fast, we're riding across terrain quickly, we're seeing a lot of mountains. But recognizing terrain traps and thinking about consequences is the key to avoiding problems as we do that. So as we sort of pan back and take a look at this in hindsight, or kind of afterwards and sort of reflect on this avalanche accident, we tell these stories as a way not to make judgment or otherwise identify. We want to identify the mistakes that were made if we can, so we don't repeat them. And so that's the reason we do case studies. And if you take an avalanche course, when you take an avalanche course, you're going to engage other case studies. And hopefully this helps you develop a practice of learning from others around this setting. Because I think that's, avalanche accidents are each unique. There's not a common theme other than that the snow was weak and they got in a piece of terrain that had a consequence. So studying that phenomenon and learning from it is something that even, and me as an avalanche educator, I've been doing this for over 25 years, and I read avalanche reports with curiosity each time because I'm curious what happened and what the snowpack was and how it set up. And I let these stories inform my avalanche courses, too. I think this is how all this stuff grows. So anyhow, the point of this is these guys were educated. They had taken the steps. I want to encourage each and every one of you guys to be involved in this as well, because I think collectively, an educated group of participants playing in the backcountry, an educated group of snow enthusiasts, are going to make better decisions and reduce the overall number of avalanche accidents. Last year, there were 9 snowmobilers caught and killed in avalanches in the U.S. That's down from 13 the year before, so that's progress. But if you look at the 10-year average, it's somewhere between 9 and 12 every year. So that's a significant portion of our community, and those accidents affect each and every one of us in different ways. So that's what an accident might look like, and that's why it's so important to dive into them and understand what was going on there. And, all respect to Alex, his family and friends and his partners, they did their very best, and I really feel for them, and they're, working through the challenges that come with all this stuff. So. Anyway, where this goes and what Alex's family is dedicated to doing is promoting the idea that avalanche education can make a difference. And so they're working with the Avalanche Alliance. Matt Entz and Dan Adams are going to be giving a presentation at the Wide Open Wisconsin dealership to sort of address this. These sort of presentations happen around the country, and they're a good introduction to the subject if you don't know much, or it's a good refresher and an engagement piece if you do know a lot and want to sort of tune in. Bring your riding buddies to this and make it a collective discussion about how avalanches impact you guys. Whether or not you're riding in avalanche terrain or not, it's an opportunity to learn from the snow each time we go out. Remember that when you are riding in avalanche terrain, you need to have an avalanche transceiver a shovel and a probe to be able to dig somebody out, to have a chance at pulling off rescue. And if you practice with this stuff, the odds are pretty good that you can make an impact and get to your partner. But if you've not practiced with your rescue gear and you've just got it fresh off the shelf and stuffed into your backpack, you don't even know if you're wearing that stuff correctly and you don't know how to use that stuff, it's going to make your response slower and less effective. Remember I said 10 to 15 minutes to get to our partners under the snow to have a chance at rescue. So we got to be quick. We got to be efficient. We got to be practiced. And if we have that gear, we have a chance. Airbags, an extra layer of defense. They can help lift a person who's caught in an avalanche to the surface of the debris and make them easier to find. But short avalanche paths, an avalanche pass with trees and other obstacles in them, can reduce the effectiveness of an airbag. So you have to understand its limitations. So what's the required gear for backcountry riding for rescuing an avalanche? These three pieces. I reiterate, these three pieces. Now, avalanche courses, this is where we're going with this conversation. What is rad about avalanche courses? What do you get from avalanche courses? How does this impact us? And why do you want to spend your time, your valuable time? You got a week or 2 weeks, maybe a year that you're going to go ride in the mountains. Why would you invest in an avalanche course? Why would you spend that time and that money on that? I'm going to make the case that when you get to play in the mountains and you get to play with some of these instructors, you get to learn things that you didn't think you'd learn. This is me with Carl Zermillen, Crazy Carl, up in Sealy Lakes, Montana. We got 5 feet of snow the night before that avalanche course, and we had a really fun day. A really fun day. So the people that teach avalanche courses, who's involved in avalanche education today? You guys probably know a few people who started and sort of built this momentum, but it's not just those people. I want to point out a couple of other folks that are involved in this. The Area Course Provider Network is growing across the West, and what it's done, we've got some of the best riders in the West. Matt Entz, Brett Rasmussen, the Stable Mountain Boys, Aaron Case, Ryan Searle. We're talking about some legends in the snowmobile community over the last 10 years have been working to develop themselves as avalanche professionals. This has taken a series of dedicated courses they've worked through, a lot of training, a lot of effort, and they've also taken a bunch of courses on how to teach avalanche courses, how to be professional instructors. And that's what Aerie's been able to do over the last 5 years in the motorized program, is help develop a broader range of course options for people to get involved in. So it's not just one spot out west where you can go get avalanche education. We think that avalanche education on the snow is what makes a difference. You can learn a lot from a book and you can learn a lot from a presentation. But at the end of the day, what you get from riding with the team and learning how to apply this stuff with your team is probably the most important part that comes out of avalanche education. So again, I point to the providers. I point to the people who are teaching these avalanche courses today. And I will encourage you guys to engage with them, to create your own experience, and learn the skills that are going to make a difference in your own riding ability, your own ability to manage avalanche risk, and ultimately your ability to have fun in the mountains. So here's a QR code. It'll take you to the website, list those course providers. There's a lot of other information right there, so feel free to snap a picture of that or come visit me later. We'll get this up. But the resources that are available on the Aerie website are a good starting point. They can take you to a lot of places, and they can connect you to the avalanche educators that are trying to make a difference. All right, so I'm going to give the stage back up to Ben here. He told you he wasn't going to come on stage again, but we're going to bring him back up. Because what we're going to do is introduce the Black Cats athlete team's efforts to work on avalanche education over the last few years.
Thanks, you, Ben. Jeff. Round of applause for Jeff, for Mary. Thanks for coming out here and doing this with us. Guys, before I show the video, I do just want to reiterate what Jeff said. Avalanche education is so important. It's one of those things that you don't think will affect you, but it's just best to be prepared. I thought I could do a speech, but apparently I can't. we partner with these guys that Jeff talked about, the Mountain Riding Lab. They gave us an opportunity to do a piece, to edit a piece that they spent a lot of time with Riley and Dave this winter. And you know what? It's not a piece to scare you. It's a piece to encourage you to find the resources and the education to go out there and be better in your craft, be a better buddy to the guys that you ride with, and get the education that you need that's required to be in the backcountry. It's more than just the beacon. It's more than just the shovel and the probe. It's the education on how to use those devices. And yeah, without further ado, let's play the video.
Nobody should ever have to experience the feeling of riding out of the mountains without their buddy. The night before he passed, he said, if I die tomorrow, I'm okay with it. I've lived a good life, and that was Rob. Rob was so kind and such a good person that he said that for us so we can cope with the fact that he's not here anymore. I felt like he would tell me, God hates a coward. You know, you can't walk away from this that we've built.
When I was a kid, I had no idea that I was ever going to become a professional snowmobiler. I don't know if I was born in the right place or moved here at the right time. I don't take it for granted, and you know, I'm just out there trying to do the best I can and ride this roller coaster as long as it lasts, because it's freaking awesome.
Town's 8,885 feet dry. That's 2,000 feet higher than God's country.
I was on that ride that my dad passed away, and after witnessing that, I was like, it's a big deal. So it was just panic, like everybody's scared. After witnessing that, I was in the same boat as Dave. Like, I wanted to give up snowmobiling. Like, it's way too dangerous. I don't want that to happen to anybody. I can't give up. Like, my dad wouldn't want me to give up just because that happened. Like, and I think it was a sign for me to get avalanche training. Like, I need it.
You know, 99% of the time, you're going to go out and you're not going to get in an avalanche, and you're not going to be affected by it, and everything's going to go okay. But that risk is always there. And I think one of the things that makes it hard for us to comprehend is that most of the time it doesn't happen. You know, we might read about it in the news, or, you know, see a couple posts online of something bad happening in another state or somewhere far away from us. But you know, when it happens to somebody close to you or in your community, or it, you know, you have a close call, usually that's what would make somebody think twice and start to seek out education and realize that it's something that they have to address.
I think it was 2014. I was leading a group of clients, and I was still, I would consider myself a rookie at that point. And I had a pretty bad near miss where I triggered a sizable avalanche that definitely could have buried me. And it was a big wake-up call for me. And so that kind of sparked this desire to, you know, take more avalanche classes to become more knowledgeable about them. So in 2016, we headed out to Lake Tahoe. My business partner, Matt, and I, and we did an instructor trainer course, and it was one of the first ever motorized specific avalanche instructor trainer courses. And so from there, if I wanted to further my avalanche education, it was kind of through the route of becoming an instructor. And so that was pretty exciting to me, because my favorite part about being a snowmobile guide was teaching folks. And so it's kind of been a natural progression going from guiding to becoming an avalanche instructor. To be a dialed mountain rider, you need to, you know, get that formal avalanche training so that you know what to look for in the snowpack, as well as the terrain, and then understand kind of how the snowpack and the terrain coincide, to know when you have safe avalanche conditions to be out in big terrain. I think riding big terrain is something that a lot of us as mountain riders strive to do. You know, some of my most fond memories are days riding with really good buddies, like kind of like my A-team, out in big mountains with a lot of avalanche terrain. It's fun to kind of push yourself in terrain like that, but it's really important to recognize that you need the right, you know, snowpack conditions to match that terrain. You know, as an avalanche educator, whenever there's a fatality in the West, we see a spike in people taking avalanche classes. And I think that's kind of what I'm trying to get at, is to convince people that that hazard's always out there, right? Every winter we're dealing with avalanche problems as mountain riders. And so let's get ahead of that. Let's be proactive and get the training so that we are making good decisions in the mountains and we get to come home.
You know, the way that we use the mountains in the backcountry as snowmobilers is different than a lot of other people. And it's really going the next step and not really just doing the easy things like buying the equipment and wearing it, but really digging into the training and learning how to use it. And most importantly, knowing how to avoid avalanches. You know, an avalanche rescue, even if you have all the gear and you have the training, is still gonna suck. There's no guarantee that just because you know how to use your transceiver that you're gonna save your riding buddy. There's so many things that are stacked against you that you just don't wanna be in that position in the first place. And so it really takes a bigger understanding of terrain and the weather and the conditions and group dynamics. And that's the kind of stuff that is focused on in avalanche courses these days. The courses that are out there now are specifically catered to how we ride and how we interact with the mountains and everything that we do. And it's really, we've never been at a better time in the sport as far as the opportunities that are out there.
All right, round of applause, guys. That was an amazing piece. Tristan, thanks for editing that. Mountain Riding Lab, thanks for capturing a lot of that footage. Again, guys, seriously, I encourage you so much to just take a picture of this QR code. Even if you utilize it later, take a picture of it, get educated, get signed up for a course. You know, this partnership is something that is obviously very near and dear to us. It is not just some corporate, you know, responsibility thing that we feel obligated to do. This is something that we want to do, and it's something that we're very, very passionate about. So I hope you guys understand that. I want to thank you guys all for coming. If you want to know more about avalanche education, you have any questions, find Jeff. I'm signing it up already. I know he's eager to answer any questions. Find myself. Find one of the Black Cats. We're happy to talk about them. We take avalanche classes every single year. It's not, and that, I don't know if you mentioned this, Jeff, but it's not a one-and-done thing. You don't take one class and you're good to go for the rest of your career. This is an ongoing education process. We take an ARRI 1 class, we take a rescue course, we take an ARRI 2 class, we take another rescue course. It's every single year. You refine those skills, you get better and better, and it just makes you a better person to be with in the backcountry. I personally, at this point, have a requirement that I probably am not gonna ride with you in the backcountry unless you have some sort of formal avalanche education. That's for my safety. I don't want to ride with somebody that doesn't know how to use their equipment. And I hope that you guys would want to feel the same. So Honestly, again, like I said, please find a ARI provider near you. The Mountain Riding Lab is the one that we use out of Idaho. They're great guys. All of the guys that Jeff mentioned are really, really amazing people, amazing athletes, and amazing ambassadors. So that's the final piece, guys. That's it. That's our Heydays presentations for the weekend. But, you know, feel free to stick around. Like I said, we've got lots of new and exciting stuff. So ask an engineer, get to know our products. And again, if you have any questions, come find us. We're happy to answer them. Thank you guys so much. We'll see you guys next year.